and we refuse to give ourselves to principles, we cut short our own lives.
Instead of their shame, my people receive a double portion. And instead of disgrace, they will rejoice in their inheritance. And so they will inherit a double portion in their land, and everlasting joy will be theirs.
Let's read one more time.
Verse 7. Instead of their shame, my people will receive a double portion.
Amen.
And instead of disgrace, they will rejoice in their inheritance.
Amen.
And so they will inherit a double portion in their land.
Amen.
And everlasting joy will be theirs.
Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. Teach us your word by your spirit. Cause us to understand these things that we can impart them unto other faithful people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Instead of their shame, my people receive a double portion. This is the final policy statement Jesus made concerning his children, particularly the kingdom. And he's saying that instead of disgrace, they rejoice in their inheritance. And so they will inherit a double portion in their land, and everlasting joy will be theirs. Last week, we started off looking at double portion, and our main test was Job. And I told you how Job, God brought problem or trouble to Job. And today I want to continue from where we left off, bringing you two dimensions of his blessings where double portion is concerned. Anytime God takes you through trouble, he gives you double. Anytime he tells you to obey and stay, he gives you double. There are times that we find ourselves in places and situations that really, frankly, we just want to walk away. We want to run away from. But the thing is that if God is saying that you've got to stay in that situation, it means that he's got something great to give you. He's got a reason why he wants you to stay so he can bless you. And sometimes bad things happen to good people. The fact that somebody is going through a rough patch in his life or her life doesn't mean that God has forsaken the person. And it doesn't mean the person is a bad person. That is why I always pray that whatever you're going through, you have the understanding to sit, kneel, do something, but pray that God open my eyes, that I might see. So I will not do anything outside of your will and your purpose for my life. Job didn't do anything bad. As a matter of fact, he was a good man. The Bible says he was the most righteous person that lived in his time. And when God had called all his sons, the angels of heaven to come around for whatever reason, the devil also showed up. And God said to the devil, have you considered? It wasn't the devil even that asked to hinder Job. It wasn't the devil that determined or demanded, I'm going to do something to Job. It was God. Because God knows what he has invested in Job. Can God be so proud about you? I pray he's always proud about you. Amen. And last week we looked at it. And the Lord said, you can't touch his life. But all that Job was going through, he thought that he was a bad person. He didn't have the insight to what was happening in the spirit realm. His wife said, curse God and die. His friends who used to eat with him and do stuff with him now are judging him. And he kept pressing on. And he said, even if he kills me, still I will worship him. I will stay in there. I will prove my love for him. Because when you love somebody, you don't love the person only when it's good times. You also love the person when bad times. When you say, I do at the altar, You don't say, I do only for good times. You say, I do for good times and bad times. And that is character. And so Job stood his ground. And the Bible said, all that he went through, the Lord God blessed him immensely. So I'm going to look at the material double portion God gives us and also the spiritual double portion God gives us this morning. Because a lot of times we key just into the material. And we're going to use Job as the material example. And then we're coming to look at Elijah and Elisha as a spiritual example. Turn with me to Job 42 from verse 10 to 17.
Job chapter 42, verse 10. After Job had prayed for his friends, the Lord made him prosperous again and gave him twice as much as he had before.
Let's hold it there. After Job had prayed for his friends, forgiving them for the way they treated him, for all that happened, the Bible says that God then made him prosperous again and he gave him a double portion. Hallelujah. Somebody say double portion. For all your trouble, may the Lord give you a double portion. I said, for all your trouble, may the Lord give you a double portion. Some of you are in a marriage that is challenging, really challenging. But God keeps telling you, stay. God keeps telling you, stay. You need to obey and stay. Don't walk away because there is a double portion for you. Your friends may be telling you, stupid. Why are you hanging around him? Why are you hanging around her? But listen to me. It's better for you. Because if the Lord God is saying stay, if you walk away, those same friends are not going to be there for you to take care of the four children. When you need somebody to get you milk, you have to find a way to get it yourself. They would have told you, let me walk away. I mean, you walk away and you'll be in that particular situation. I've seen situations where God has said to a folk in marriage, stay in the relationship. All the guy is doing is that he sleeps too much. But he blesses you. Listen, he does the dishes. He makes sure the children are okay. He does the ironing. Before service Sunday morning, he stays up Saturday night, do all the ironing. Do stuff. Listen to me. A lot of men don't do things like that. A lot of men don't go to the kitchen. They don't wash dishes. Anytime you finish cooking, he is there washing the dishes. And because he fails to do something small in another aspect of the marriage, you want to leave him. And God is telling you, stay. And your friends are telling you, leave him. Listen to me. When he goes, remember, you have four children. Maybe five. Maybe six. How are you going to take care of the children? And your chances of remarriage is very slim. Because a lot of men want to go for brand new anyway. I must choose my words carefully. Glory to God, PC. But seriously, he had to pray for his friends. His friends said a whole bunch of things and we are not treating Job as a subject, so I can't go into it. Then 11 says something.
Verse 11. Brothers and sisters, and everyone who had known him before came and ate with him in his house. They comforted him and consoled him over all the trouble the Lord had brought upon him.
They said they comforted him for all the trouble the Lord has brought upon him. Not only marriage, but sometimes in your job. Horrible boss you have, but God has said, stay. No, the difference here is hearing the voice of God. I'm not just saying that when you are dying somewhere, you just have to stay regardless. I'm saying when God has spoken into the situation, no matter how difficult it is, you've got to listen to God. Because you don't know what God is going to do. That boss might be horrible. But when you prayed about another job, God said, stay. Stay. You don't know what might happen. Oh, but God, the man has been in the job for 30 years. That's even more reason why you should stay. Because he's going to kick him out. You might take his position. You don't know what God is going to do. You've got to stay. Hallelujah. Oh, but these days, church is something. These days, hey, God says stay in the church, stay. Glory to God. I have been in the maintenance team for all these years. I'm getting bored. Yes, get bored, but stay. Hallelujah. I have been in the prayer group for all this time. Every time we will go, the same prayer topic. Can we change the prayer topic a bit? The same prayer topic. Last week we prayed that prayer. Last 2 weeks we prayed that prayer. Last week, the same thing. God says, stay. What we get from ushering is the same faces we see. They are not even nice. The Lord said, stay. You stay. Because you see, when you have stayed, He will cause people to come and celebrate you. He will cause your double portion to come through. Let's continue.
And each one gave him a piece of silver and a gold ring. Verse 12. The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the first. He had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. Verse 13. And he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. The first daughter he named Jemima, the second Keziah, and the third Keren Hapuch. Nowhere in all the land were there found women as beautiful as Job's daughters, and their father granted them an inheritance along with their brothers. After this, Job lived 140 years. He saw his children and their children to the fourth generation, and so he died old and full of years.
Wow. That is what it means when God gives you a double portion. He had physical blessings. And every time you see the word blessed in the Old Testament and the New Testament, it follows physical things and spiritual things. It says the latter part of Job was more than the first because of the double portion. He had 14,000, which he had 7,000 before. Double portion. 6,000 four by fours. Camel. He had 3,000 before. 1,000 yoke of oxen and 1,000 donkeys. And he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. It says the first daughter he named what? Jemima. Now the next one, I don't know who taught us all, but is it Keziah or Kezia? Whichever. And listen, these daughters were pretty. The daughters he had before were not as pretty. Glory to God. If you parade them on the catwalk, people will single them out. Pretty. Anytime his daughters pass by, people go like that. That is the scripture. Amazing. The Bible teaches that his daughters were the most beautiful. They were talked of the town. Everybody wanted to know them. This is what happens when God gives you double. May your daughters be beautiful. I said, may your daughters be beautiful. There's something about God. You know, some of us, we didn't look handsome or be pretty. When we came to Christ, some of you, your life BC was terrible. I know some of you. BC, you look horrible. Hallelujah. Before Christ, you were terrible. But after Christ, you look good. You smell good. You act good. Some of you, even before Christ, you didn't work properly. Some of you ladies, you work like you are in the military, going to fight Al-Qaeda. Today, you don't work that way anymore. You take special steps. It's like you're on the catwalk. Hallelujah. That is what God does. God will give you double. Hallelujah. Husbands, God will give you double. Not double wives, but He will give you double in your wife. You didn't hear that. I said He will give you double in your wife. You'll be one wife, but she will be double. Glory to God. The hair that is gone, supernatural hair will come. Sandaraba. And if the super hair, and if the supernatural hair doesn't come, she will buy it from the shop. And if she buys it from the shop, it still belongs to her. She can roll it like this, roll it like that, roll it like that. It's still her hair. You can decide whether it's synthetic or human hair. It's still her hair. Rebobo Shandaraba Sada. You can buy beauty in the shop. Are you understanding that? He said, we'll give you double, double in one woman, double. Glory to God. She will look good. Everything will stand. Shenderebo. Rakatayaba. I'm preaching the word of God. Kaberebebe shenderebo. Hallelujah. Anytime you are working, you think about how you go home. Amen. Glory to Jesus. And what I saw we call power. You know, these days, oh, shenderebo. Let me preach. But the same way God will give your man also double, it doesn't mean he's going to give you double husband. But in that same man, things that were flabby will become strong. Shantaraba Sekab, I'm preaching the word. Hallelujah. Amen. The tummy that is this way will come up and say, Yandaraba. Some people, when they have to find things, they can't find things. We have to take the tummy out before they can find things. Rebo Shandaraba. But when the Lord gives your husband double, Harebo Shandaraba Sadara. Hallelujah. Anytime you go to the bathroom and you do this and you can't see it, it means there's a problem with the tummy. Namo Shekaya Mande. Hallelujah. When the husband lifts up the hands, there's all manner of things hanging out. Glory to Jesus. But for this new season, there will be double. When the hands are lifted, you'll be stiff, firm. Understand? So. Hallelujah. He said, nowhere in all the land were there found women as beautiful as Job's daughters. So when it came to human being, God is saying that I will increase your beauty. I will increase how handsome you are. I will increase your influence. Some of us only influence 2, 3, 4. The Lord says that I will increase that influence. I will make you affluent. I will cause grace to be your portion. That everywhere you go, people will stop and they will ask you questions. When you go to the marketplace, they'll be watching you and looking at you like that. They will think some celebrity has just walked in. Indeed, you are. Hallelujah. Because your presence of God will be all over you. You will not speak much. When you go to interview, they will rise for you to sit before they sit. Are you understanding that? And by the time the interview is over, they tell you, we don't need to call you. Listen to me. The job is yours immediately. Glory to God. That is double. Hallelujah. Amen. It says, after this, Job lived 140 years. He saw his children. They are children to the fourth generation. Listen, I prophesy. May God cause you to die at a very old age. Having seen your children's children in the name of Jesus, I release grace and might over your life. May your womb bear children. And may the womb of those children bear children. And the womb of those children that bear children also bear children. In the name of Jesus. May the Lord expand you to the left and to the right. And cause greatness to be your portion. Hallelujah. I decree and I declare by the might of Jehovah that this double portion be yours in all you do and everywhere you go. Just like Job, may God bless you and may you say that indeed I feel blessed. 17 says, and so he died old and full of years. That is your portion. So physically, this is what Jesus was saying in Luke. That in the manifesto, policy statement, you have capability and capacity to walk in this anointing. And I will give you enough and more than enough material goods. But for those who don't feel satisfied with that, the most important thing also is spiritual blessing. A spiritual double. Let us see what it says. 2 Kings 2. 9 to 15. So not only does he give you physical, he also gives you spiritual. Oh, Rabbi San, and I pray that as we get into this word, you will catch the spirit of this teaching. And you will hold on to the double he's bringing you even through this teaching.
2 Kings chapter 2, verse 9. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what can I do for you before I am taken from you? Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha replied. Verse 10. "You have asked a difficult thing," Elijah said. "Yet, if you see me when I'm taken from you, it will be yours, otherwise not." As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them, and Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, "My father, my father, the chariots and horsemen of Israel," and Elisha saw him no more. Then he took hold of his own clothes and tore them apart. He picked up the cloak that had fallen from Elijah and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. Then he took the cloak that had fallen from him and struck the water with it. "Where now is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" he asked. When he struck the water, it divided to the right and to the left, and he crossed over. Verse 15. The company of the prophets from Jericho, who were watching, said, "The spirit of Elijah is resting on Elisha." And they went to meet him and bowed to the ground before him.
Hallelujah. This is a double portion spiritually. How do we gain spiritual double portion? It comes by service. That also comes from God. When he gives a specific commandment and specific instructions to tarry and stay where he's called us to stay. Whereas physical double portion comes by circumstance, job situations, marriage, and so on and so forth. Spiritual double portion comes by service and only in the house of God. And connected to an apostle. Unless this happens, you cannot get a spiritual double portion. And you need to understand the spirit of this teaching because I'm going to go deep with you today. The Bible said or teaches that Elijah had a school of prophets. Because what happened in those days is that if you're a prophet, you have juniors who follow you. And usually there'll be a school who go by your philosophy and the way you live. In fact, that practice went on even to Jesus' time. And that is why someone like John the Baptist had his own disciples, Jesus had his own disciples, and so on and so forth. So these school of prophets who reported to Elijah were around him, but did not serve him the way they should. Then came a businessman, somebody who has never been to the school of the prophets. He was plowing with his oxen. And the Lord revealed to him that this is the apostle you need to serve. And when he caught the vision, he threw out all the plows, cooked the oxen, distributed the meat to the family. And he said, "From today going, I'm no longer a businessman. I am going to pour water on the feet and the hands of the apostle or the prophet Elijah." And when he came close to Elijah, he made sure that everything he ought to do. Now, I don't have time to go into this teaching, but if you study the text, you realize that Elijah is not an easy person to serve. But God kept telling him, "Stay." That is the problem we have in the church. So we're not receiving the double portion blessing we ought to receive. When the Lord says that I am the son of the Father, it means I carry a double portion of his unction. If you say you are the son of Mr. Kwedu, or the son of Mr. Prempeh, or the son of Mr. Buafu, you should have something about him. You should look like him. And by biblical definition, you should do more than Mr. Kwedu did. That is how the Bible works. And so you cannot call somebody your father, be it physical or spiritual, and not find anything about that person rubbed over you. That is why sons are there to continue the legacies of fathers. And you cannot continue the legacy of father if you haven't spent time. And that anointing only comes by service. So the Bible said Elisha served Elijah all these years. And I tell you, he was a difficult man. There were times where he discouraged Elisha from serving. But Elisha got to the understanding that God wants him to stay. And so if he's going to get the double portion, he must stay. But you see, the other sons to Elijah, who could not handle Elijah's temperament. Elijah can say something right now and then change his mind and do something else. So they could not. So they stay back. And they would not be close to him. But Elisha made it a point to be close to him. And the Bible said when he got the understanding that his master Elijah was going to be taken away from him, he got even closer. Anytime they travel, he was there. And when this series started, that is the journey he had to go through these cities before he comes into glorification, Elisha determined that I will be with you all the way. The first point, Elijah turns to Elisha and says to Elisha, what have I done to you? Go home. Don't follow me. A lot of us will pick our bags and walk away, especially for the kind of person Elijah was. This gives us the legitimacy to walk. And then we can say, well, it's not my fault. He told me to go, so I left. But Elisha said, as long as God lives, I am not leaving you. Because number one, God has shown me that I must carry this unction. The Bible said the 50 prophets who were part of the sonship of Elijah were staying afar. And when they came, they saw Elisha, they tell Elisha, do you know God is going to take your master away from you? No. It's all of us, our master. But they have come to the resolve that, well, where they are very comfortable. So they didn't get a double portion. They went to Gilgal. They came to Bethel. They continued the journey and finally came to the Jordan. But listen to me, church. When they came to the Jordan, then he said, Elijah said to Elisha, in fact, when they came to the Jordan, instead of them finding some cloth of bread to go over, Elijah took his mantle and he slapped the water. And immediately it parted into two. Dry land appeared. And Elijah and Elisha crossed over. On the other side, Elijah said to Elisha, tell me, what can I do for you before I'm taken from you? Listen, they had to go through the whole journey up to this time. And then Elisha, having gotten an insight into the spirit, said, let me inherit a double portion of your spirit. If I have served you all these years, I need a double portion. I don't need your property. Listen to me. He could have said, your home, can I have it? Your car, can I have it? Because the guy was being taken away. Your oxen and every other property. No. The secret is, anytime you're serving a man of God, don't seek what he has physically. Seek his blessing. Because the blessing will translate into other things, material things will not translate into. Hallelujah. A lot of times we seek, and because we are so materialistic and material driven, we judge on things like that. But listen to me. If you take even everything a man of God has got away from him, because he is blessed, they will come back again. So you cannot criticize somebody for what he has and what he hasn't got. But for you to be able to walk in that, and let me give you a typical example. I think I've given this example before, but I'll do it again. Abraham, the Bible said he looked at his properties. And he shared all his properties among his many children. Because by the time he was dying, he had many children. Keturah's children, other concubines. The Bible didn't mention their names, but their children were there. Shared everything. But when it came to Isaac, the promised one, did not give him any property. Rather laid hands on him and blessed him. Said, don't seek property. Seek the blessings of the Lord. And the blessings of the Lord will translate, not just into property, but into everything you need in life. Hallelujah. So he could have said, what do you want? Tell me. Oh, you know the house you are living, because I know you have been taken away. The cars you're living. No. He wasn't interested. He said, I want the unction on your life. I want a double portion on your life. Then Elijah responded, you have asked a difficult thing. No. Let's pause for a minute. Why did he use the language a difficult thing? He is going. He doesn't need that unction there. But why did he say a difficult thing? He said that difficult thing, when I research it, so beautiful. He said that difficult thing because what it takes for you to get a double portion is service. And this is what he says. Yet if you see me when I'm taking from you, it will be yours. In other words, you must serve till the very end. You don't serve to the middle. Joshua had to serve to the very end. And remember, Moses had other children, but none of his biological children inherited his spirit because they didn't serve. Joshua, who was not his biological child, inherited. That's why I tell people, it is not automatic that a man of God will be inherited by his biological son. Anybody who finds it important and necessary to see that their future is linked to that man of God and be served faithfully, that double portion can come to them. Sometimes God breaks the rules that way. And he said, if you see me leave, it will be yours. Let me play with those words a few minutes. If you see me, what does that mean? Number one, that word, if you see me leave, means that you must be consistent. When you put your hand in the plow, you don't remove it. Some of the people we serve in our lives didn't make it easy for us, but we served. Sometimes we even felt that the people we were serving didn't like us, but we served. And he made us better people. And today we can be better pastors. Hallelujah. Some of the people we looked up onto did not treat us fairly, but we served. And that is what he's saying here, is that if you see me go, if you put up your place and say to yourself that I have come to this ministry to serve, I have come to make sure that God's will is done in this ministry, and I give my totality, he says, don't be a person that puts his hand into the plow and remove it. He says, as you are a beginner, you got to also be a finisher. Give your totality till death do us part. He said, if you see me go, it is difficult. It is not difficult because I cannot give it. It is difficult on your part because I am temperamental. Because I can be here and I can be there. Remember Elijah's connection with Obadiah. When he met with Obadiah, look at Obadiah's testimony about Elijah. Obadiah told Elijah, he said, the way you are, you cannot be predicted. You decide this today, tomorrow, you decide that today. And so if you're telling me to go and speak to Ahab, what guarantee do I have? Maybe I'll just leave you here and the Spirit of the Lord will carry you somewhere else and I will be in trouble. Obadiah gave us a picture of how Elijah was. Serving such a person is difficult. He messes your diary up. He can tell you the next 4 weeks, this is what we are doing. And then you plan according to that. And next time he tells you, no, we are moving here. They say, oh, but I've already made an appointment over here. They say, yeah, well, cancel it. We move. I said, can I cancel it? But that is the way he went. But he said, if you see me go, two, to see me go means that you must project me. Every son who must benefit from the blessing of his spiritual father must project his spiritual father. You must project the spiritual father. You must make sure that you celebrate that spiritual father. That is why the Lord Jesus always said that the Father sent me. He does things in the name of the Father. When Lazarus was put in the tomb, Jesus could have just walked there. He's God, remember. He could have just walked there, moved the tomb out, and then just bring Lazarus out. But he must project his father. He stood there and he said, Father, I know all the time you hear me. When I pray, you hear me. And so I ask you, and then he called forth. Lazarus. A son projects the father. A son does not sit in the barbering shop When other people are disrespecting the father and he joins in, when other people are gossiping untrue things about the father, a son to a ministry, be it FCI, KICC, wherever you go to, when things are being said that you know is not true, in fact, even sometimes you know it is true, but the context in which it's being spoken of is not right, a son does not sit there and contribute, you will never get a double portion. In fact, you get no portion. Hallelujah. He said, when you see me go, it will happen to you. And so we have to. But if you allow me to just bring it to our level, forget about son and father relationship, even our normal friendship. We should organize our life in such a way, especially a lot of us from Africa and the black land, where there's so much pulling each other down, where there's so much tearing each other down, where there's so much this one belongs to me and that one does not belong to me, when there's so much, we call it PhD, pull him down. We need to understand that when your brother is making it, you must celebrate that brother. You must let him go. You must push him to go. Because listen, this might be his time. But as long as God lives, your time will also come. Celebrate people who have gone ahead of you. Glory to God. They buy a house, be excited for them. They buy a car, be excited for them. They get married, buy them presents. Shower them with confetti. Do something good. Hallelujah. Because when your marriage also comes, people will celebrate you. In fact, if they are ungrateful and they don't celebrate you, God will raise other people and you will get a double portion. Motivations of hate, motivations of greed are all self-defeating. Hallelujah. That is why Elijah was telling Elisha, if you see me go, if you push me, if you celebrate me, listen to me, a double portion will come to you. Brothers, let's celebrate one another. Husbands, let's celebrate our wives. Wives, let's celebrate our husbands. Pastors, let's celebrate our congregation. Congregation, let's celebrate our pastors. Workers, let's celebrate our bosses. And bosses, let's celebrate our workers. Because you don't know who will save who. You don't know who will open door for who. And the fact that God is opening a great door for you today does not mean that it's the exclusion of every other person. The fact that God has done it for you today, didn't do it yesterday, it means that God can do it for somebody else tomorrow. Glory to Jesus. When you see somebody making it, bless him. If it's not your friend, go on your knees and pray for him. Some of us, we are tailbearers. We like bad news. Anytime we hear something evil is happening to someone, we get on the phone quickly and begin to call people. Have you heard? Have you heard? He couldn't pay his rent. Have you heard? He's been repossessed. Have you heard? Because you are envious of the house. So now you hear that he's been repossessed. You are excited so that he can rent just like you. But when you got that house, it was only 2-bedroom flat. Only 2-bedroom flat. If the Lord should open your eyes to see, yours that is coming isn't 2-bedroom. It is a whole 4-bedroom detached house with your own lawn, your garden, your garage, and everything else. But because you are myopic and you are wicked and you cannot see beyond yourself, you think anybody that gets something is doing it at your own disadvantage. There is enough of God's blessing to go around for everybody to enjoy. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. So he said, let me go. He said, let me go. If you see me go, you see me go. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And the third aspect of that language, and you see me go, also has to do with what you receive as a person. Glory to God. Because you cannot push somebody on the direction the person should go without embracing the opposite effect. Are you understanding it? Without embracing the opposite effect. So when you see the person go, you also position yourself for that same blessing. Glory to God. Benny Hinn gave a testimony. And he said he will follow Kathleen Coleman's ministry. And some people even questioned him. Because Kathleen Coleman was a woman. And how can a man follow a woman's ministry? Another sickness we have in the body of Christ. But one day we'll be healed. Amen. And genuinely follow. But you see, there were other people around Kathleen Coleman who did not catch her spirit. Kathleen Coleman would go to a meeting and he would just do And people will just fall, receiving healings and stuff. But Benny Hinn followed, became a disciple. Others were telling him, how can a man follow a woman and a whole bunch of stuff? But he did not listen. It was him that carried her spirit. But look at the double portion. Kelly Coleman only affected America. And a few, if not the whole America, few parts of America. But when Benny Hinn caught that spirit, he affected the whole world. He was in India, and there were millions and millions of people. And all he has to do is, and people were flying like flies, falling out. People were getting healed. I mean, people coming out of their wheelchairs and stuff. Because he closed his ears and said to himself, if you see me go, you will. And look at what happens there. He said, as they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated two of them. So it is like two stages. They were talking. And they were talking. So, you know about the going, look at this, look at this useless guy standing up there. But at this point, the 50 prophets were standing there looking on. Look at them. They don't know what they are missing. Each of them coming close. They say, hey, I know you are a terrible man, but just sometimes I'm not sure whether you are here or you are there. Keep up. Sometimes I'm not sure whether you are there or you are here. But hey, so how do you do this? How were you able to deal with Jezebel? How were you able to deal with this thing about Carmel? How were you able? He was giving him secrets. And then fire separated the two of them. Are you understanding that? And by the time it pushed him away, all of a sudden he could see the chariots of Israel. Now, these were the spiritual agents that protected Israel in the spirit realm. And somehow, immediately, his eyes were opened to understand the guards that have been put around. The Lord has also placed that same thing around you. He has put fire around you. He has put a hedge of protection. May you never break it, and may that hedge never be broken in the name of Jesus. May you be protected going out, protected coming in all you do. But listen, it says that when he separated them, and Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Then Elisha saw this and cried out, my father, my father. The Greek version would say, my apostle, my apostle. My father, my father. Why? Because he has served in a sonship role. And Bible says that inheritance are of fathers. And by virtue of his faithful service to the man of God, especially, he haven't done that to the end. Because remember, that's what he said. He said, when you see me go, in other words, when you complete the assignment, not when you start and then you walk away. When you complete it, the double portion will be yours. And so he shouted, my father, my father. In other words, he's telling you, I have a legitimate right to take this portion. The chariots and horsemen of Israel. And Elisha saw him no more. Then he took hold of his own clothes and tore them apart. He picked up the cloak that had fallen from Elijah and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. Took it. At which point he was feeling good. Because every prophetic thing comes from the body. Because in those days, to be a son, they either spit into your mouth or you take a sweat or something off the body, and then you begin to walk in that direction. So having gotten this off his body was a legitimate reference. And look at what he did. He picked up the cloak that had fallen from Elijah and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. Then he took the cloak that had fallen from him and struck the water with it. Where now is the Lord, the God of Elijah? He asked. When he struck the water, it divided to the right and to the left, and he crossed over. Let me give you a revelation here. He took the thing. Remember, he said, "My Father, my Father." Then the double portion came. To test the double portion, he must make sure that that same unction is there. So he said, "The God of Elijah." Now, it doesn't mean that God is a different God, but he was connecting it to the ability and the unction he carried. So if your spiritual father carries wealth, and you come to a place where you need God to move in that direction, you can also say the God of whatever the person's name is, and pray in accordance. There's nothing wrong with that. But he says, because his particular one, what was his master, Elijah, and so he picks it and he strikes it, the same anointing, he opened. Elijah raised the dead. He raised the dead. But when you study, you realize that Elijah did a whole bunch of things. Elisha did more than Elijah did. Elisha ended up living in a whole palace. He became an advisor to the king. The king actually called him his father. Elisha had a servant called Gehazi, and Gehazi did not follow that step. Gehazi was not interested in the blessings. He was interested in the money. He was interested in the cars he had, and interested in the houses he had, interested in everything that Elisha had, minus the blessing. So when Naaman came and Naaman gave him stuff, and Elisha said, "I'm not going to take anything from you. This is enough. You healed. That's good. Go, 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 go. Go, go, go." And Elisha said, "Look, can't you?" He said, "No, I'm not taking anything from you." And Gehazi looks on it and he said, "No, no, no. You cannot let this man go scot-free." And then he went and meet him and he said, "My master has changed his mind. Bring me the goose." Do you know that it's so serious that nobody followed the double portion Elisha received? Elisha went to the grave with the double portion. The Bible says that the portion that he received from Elijah was so much strong in the grave, somebody was thrown into the grave for burial. As soon as the person was thrown in there, took the bone of Elisha, immediately he came back to life. He had to give the person home. Maybe it's possible that person took the double. No, it's not possible because you have to serve first because the person didn't serve. But the unction brought that person back to life because nobody, there were so many people around. That is why I tell you, if you call somebody your spiritual father and what he stands for in life, it is not seen in your life. Over a period of years, he is not your father. It must be seen in your life. If he's a righteous person, you must be righteous. If he's a prosperous person, you must be prosperous. And he said, the company of the prophets from Jericho who were watching said, "The spirit of Elijah is resting on Elisha." And they went to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. They could have also been getting that same double portion. But thank God they recognized that the spirit was with him. My final scripture is Jesus himself. Let us see what he says. John 14, 12 to 14.
John chapter 14, verse 12. "I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it.
He says, I tell you the truth. Just as Jesus was also about to go, his going is typical of Elijah's one. In this case, he wasn't just leaving one son. He was leaving several sons called the disciples or the apostles. And he says to them that the works I did, you will do greater. Put it in this language, it means that you have a double portion. Because I go to the Father. He said, anybody who will serve will have a double portion. And this is what he declared in Luke, according to Isaiah 61. A double portion, spiritual double portion. And you see, those who worked in it, they got it. There were things the apostles did, Jesus didn't do. Jesus healed the sick, he raised the dead. But do you realize that there were no aprons coming from his body to heal people? His shadow wasn't healing people, but the disciples were doing more. Peter's shadow was healing. Paul, who didn't know Jesus, who didn't work with Jesus, only had an encounter on the Damascus road, began to operate in the double unction of Jesus. But the good news is this. We, in this generation, also have that same double portion. We're supposed to do greater. We're supposed to heal the sick. No, we've been sick. We're supposed to raise the dead. We're supposed to do all those things. And we have to walk in that. Where we put Christ Jesus first. Like he said to Elijah, if you see me go, or when you see me go, you will receive the double portion. In the same way, he's saying to us, if you see me go, yes, spiritually he's here, but physically he's gone. But he left his body, of which he is the head. That is the body of Christ. That is you and I. And he's saying that our service to him, because he was not there like that, a disciple served him physically. They poured water on his feet and they did all manner of things with him. He's not there, but he's here. And he's saying that serve me. Make sure the church is a great place. Make sure when people walk into the place where my name has been placed, they will give me glory. Make sure in your singing you do it beautifully. Not with animosity and grudge. Make sure in your ushering you do it beautifully. Not with animosity and grudge. Make sure in your pastoral work you do it peacefully and lovingly. Make sure being an elder, you do it. Everything God has called you to do in his house, you do it with all your heart. He says, by that, the double portion will come. Hallelujah. A lot of times we are waiting for pastor to come and lay hands on us. We are waiting for, yes, it's okay, it's good. But it comes a time also where pastor is not there. But because you have served, God will bring deliverance. Hallelujah. Sometimes because of our biological disposition, sometimes because of the things we've been through in our life, sometimes the curses of our family, we tend to get sick, we tend to go through things, we tend to see devastating things come around us. But because God lives, because he lives, because he's poured his blood, because by his stripes we are healed, those things will not take us out. Am I talking to somebody? This morning, let me prophesy to somebody that the grace of God and the might of God is made available because you serve in the house. And because you serve in the house, your portion is a double portion. A double portion of grace. A double portion of peace. You don't need to be a pastor to be a healer. You don't need to be a pastor to be someone who walks in faith. You don't need to be a pastor before you can see things. You don't need to be a pastor before you can prophesy. I want to declare over your life that because of the double portion of grace, you will prophesy. And so we got to be able to know that as we serve, directions for our lives will come through dreams. And we should pay particular attention. Some of us have to buy a dream book and put by our bedside. And we record the dreams. I'm talking about authentic dreams. I'm not talking about the amala you ate, the fufu you ate, the car food. No, when you eat that thing 11 p.m. and you go to bed, the car will come for his feet. You hit bed Only barely have you sleep and you see a cow coming. Bruga, 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 bruga. What is this? Yes, I need my feet. In fact, if you go by what they are saying in the news, you might have a horse. You might have a horse. Nay! Is that what? Nay! No, that's not coming from God. That's not coming from God. But you have good dreams. God will show you things. Are you understanding it? To guide your life. A lot of times where you need to be, God shows it to you. You know what? Can I say? God always speaks. Listen. He always speaks. You know, sometimes you see some things and you say it's deja vu. And you say, no, this is deja vu. No, it is not deja vu. It's because you have seen that same scene played in a dream, but you didn't take it serious. So it's feeling like, I have seen this before. I have realized this before. I have, but God was speaking then. Sometimes he wakes you up 5 a.m., wakes you up 4 a.m., and all he needs you to do is get up and pray. Get up and pray. And you go, give you a direction. Something awful is going to happen. You dream of flies and terrible things, and you get up and you don't do anything about it. No, that is a symbol of sickness. You dream of feces and things like that. That is a symbol of sickness. You rise up, you got to fast. If it means calling your boss and taking a day off and spending time to pray, for Bible says that he reveals to redeem. Are you understanding that? You dream and you see animals chasing you. It's demonic assignment. Especially cows chasing you. You see cockroaches. It's terrible. You want to have beautiful dreams. Like walking in a green field. That is prosperity. Are you understanding that? Eating in your dream anyhow. You wake up. You got to pray about it. It depends though. Having funny feelings in the dream. Pray about it. I'm not going to go into that. I know you want me to develop it, isn't it? Shall we rise? We'll continue next week.
Our mission is raising overcomers, setting the captives free. Freedom Center International is here to support you in every step that you take with the Word of God as you seek spiritual and emotional wholeness. And we hope you've been blessed by today's message. Worship with us at 38 Upper Wickham Lane, Welling, Kent, DA16-3HF, or give us a call on 0207-277-8700. You can also visit us online at fcichapel.org. And remember, there is progress in freedom.